Okay, thank you very much. So I would like to first thank the organizer and the scientific committee for inviting me. so I'm going to talk about some recent work with my PhD student, Thibaut Lefebvre. And this is going to be about the Mark Lane spectrum. Anosov geodesic flow. So let me explain the problem first. So we take a manifold, a closed manifold. Equipped with a metric, Riemannian metric, so G is the metric. we consider the set of closed geodesic. So, in fact, if it's a well-known, very old well-known theorem that if G has negative curvature, so I will always write the sectional curvature with a k, like this. And the curvature tensor will be an r, but it will come later. In each free homotopy class, there exists a unique closed geodesic. For G, and we will denote by L of G, so I will denote it gamma of C, so free homotopy class will be denoted by C. There exists a unique closed geodesic gamma C for G, and I will denote by LG. Will be the Riemannian length. Of gamma C. Okay. So the set of free homotopy class you can identify to the set of conjugacy classes of the fundamental group. So we will denote by C the set of free homotopy class. Which you can identify to the set of conjugacy class of a fundamental group. So what is the Mark Lane spectrum? So it will be a map that I will call L of G, big L, which go from C to R plus, and which to C associate just the length of this closed geodesic in the free homotopy class in G of C. Okay. So the there is a folklore, or actually it's I don't know if it was the question was posed before, but I think it appears in a paper of Keith Burns and Katok in 85. So there was a sort of conjecture. So you can find it in the paper of Burns Katok. Is that if you have two metric G and G prime with negative curvature. And if they have the same Mach length spectrum, then there exists a diffeomorphism such that one metric is the pullback by the other, so they are isometric. So this would say that this Mach length spectrum really is a parameter of the set of isometric classes on negatively curved manifold. So this conjecture was actually solved in dimension 2. So it was a theorem by Othal in 1990. And there is also a proof by Chris Crook, which used some result of Feldman and Ornstein, which say that in dimension 2, the conjecture is actually true. And in fact, it's been proved. I mean, it's also well known that if having the same Mach length spectrum is equivalent to say that the two geodesic flows are conjugate. So you can also view this question as if you have two geodesic flows which are conjugate, is it true that the conjugacy is actually coming from an isometry, the sort of rigidity of conjugacy of geodesic flows in negative curvature. So in higher dimension, the problem is still open. So there are few results. So there is a result of Katok, actually. In 99, well, I don't remember. So theorem of Katok, which said that in higher dimension, if you know that G and G prime are conformal one to each other and also negatively curved, then if you also know that they have the same Mach length spectrum, it's a fact that G equals G prime. But in this case, there is no diffeomorphism gauge. The proof is actually very short. It's a very clever proof, but like half a page. So in higher dimension, we know when the two metric are conformal one to each other, but we don't know in general. But there is one other result in higher dimension, which is due to Besson, Courtois, and Gallo, and Amenstadt. In 85, it's a sort of corollary from the work of Besson, Courtois, Gallo on the entropy rigidity. Which say that if MG is a locally symmetric space of negative curvature, and if you have another manifold, well, actually, okay, let's say that's the same. And if G prime is such that the Mach length spectrum is equal to LG, then G is the pullback by diffeomorphism of the first one. So this work using the entropy rigidity actually solved the problem when one of them essentially has constant curvature or is a locally symmetric space. And I think, as far as I know, at least that's the only case where one has result on this Mach length spectrum rigidity. So we managed to do some progress in any dimension, actually. So let me state the result. Ah, okay. Maybe I should first, before I set the result, I should say that, in fact, to pose the problem, you don't really need to have a negative curvature. So there is a natural class of metric such that this Markland spectrum still makes good sense. Is for anosov metric. If you have a geodesic flow which is anosov, this property is also true that you have one unique closed geodesic in any free homotopy class. So in fact, the conjecture can be extended to geodesic flow with anosov flow. Riemann metric with anosov geodesic flow. Where it's not negatively curved? You have some example, I think, by maybe Donet or... I think you can construct manifold with which have a bit of positive curvature, but still the flow is anosov. Sorry? You don't need a negative curvature to have anosov in general. So it still makes sense. And there are examples. This I know. I think it's maybe Gabriel must know that. I think it's Donet.
Yeah, you even have examples of surfaces that live in R3, so that the metric you use from R3 gives them such a basic form.
Yeah.
Which doesn't never happen in the curvature.
Yeah. So we have actually several theorems. So let me say the first. So in this case, we assume that Mg zero. So we fix a metric G zero is either of dimension 2 and G0 has anosov geodesic flow. Or dimension n bigger than 2. And G0 has another anosov geodesic flow plus non-positive curvature. I should say actually that in the proof of Ottal and Kroc, in the proof of Kroc, this also work in non-positive curvature. Ottal proved it for strictly negative. So assume Mg is either a surface with anosov geodesic flow, or in higher dimension, we need to add this condition. Then there exists a CK neighborhood for some K which is explicit of G0. Such that for any metric, so CK neighborhood U, for any metric in this neighborhood, the conjecture is true. So in fact, the result is even new in dimension 2, because in dimension 2, in the anosov case, this is a global result. You don't need the metric to be closed, but you need some assumption on the curvature.
Which is the value of K?
So K, in our proof, it's really non-optimal. I mean, I think with a lot of work, we could get down to something, maybe like 2 or 3 or something. But in what we do, we get something like 3n over 2 plus 8 or something like this. Because it comes from analytic method, and I'll explain a bit of the proof. But likely, maybe C2 or C3, maybe we hope could work. Yeah. So that's the first one. So we have another one which is a bit related to this, and which is actually related to a question of Gromov about the minimal filling conjecture, and which I think which was posed by Kroc. It was a question posed by Kroc and Kroc and Darbikov. So this is the theorem 2. So take MG0 to be the same MG0 as before. And assume, well, then there exists a CK neighborhood U of G0 such that for any metric in U, so in this case actually K is a bit better. In this case, K I think has to be bigger than N over 2 plus 2 or something like this. Comes from the proof again. Such that if the length spectrum of G is bigger than the length spectrum of G0, meaning that for any free homotopy class, the length of this one is bigger than the length of this one, then the volume for the first metric is bigger than the volume of the metric we have fixed. And if this is an equality, then G is isometric to G0. So this is quite similar to this filling, minimal filling conjecture of Gromov, in at least in the closed setting. So the length, the Markland spectrum sort of tell you something about the volume as well. So that's the second result. So let me comment a little bit about this. So as I said before, this really says that locally, at least, the length Markland spectrum is really like a parameter for the isometric class of Anosov surface, for instance. So in fact, in the proof, we managed to get some sort of stability estimate. So we can also say, so let me maybe mention this. We can also say something which is not, at least it seems hard to obtain from the proof of Hotal or Crook, saying that, let's say, if the Markland spectrum are close one to each other, can you say that the metric are actually close? It's a sort of stability. So this we also managed to get from this method. So we can control the distance of the isometric class, as long as we know, of course, that the metric are close enough at the beginning. We can control the distance between the isometric class in terms of the Markland spectrum, and this is a Hölder stability estimate. So let me write it here. So again, MG0 is as before. So what we can see that for any S small as you like, the statement might look a bit technical, but we'll see. There exists a C which depends on G0 and on S. There exists an epsilon and there exists a nu of S which is a big O of S as S is small. It's kind of explicit actually. So something of the order of S, such that for any G where G minus G0 in the norm of G0 is in Cn or Ck is less than epsilon, so this means that, as before, that G is close enough from G0 in some CK norm. There exists a DFAO C such that C star of G minus G0 in some Sobolev norm, actually negative Sobolev norm, so this is a kind of weak norm. But if you know a priori that G and G prime and G0 are bounded in some CK norm, you can interpolate and get some. It will change the exponent, but this estimate will give you also estimate on some CK norm. If you know a priori that the CN norm for G is bounded, for instance. So this is controlled by C time LG minus 1. I'll explain what this means. In L infinity of C. And here you have a power which is 1/2 minus nu of S. So what is L of G? So this is Sobolev, negative Sobolev norm. And L of G is just LG over LG0. And what is 1? 1 is just 1 when you evaluate on the conjugacy class of C. So this quantity just controls the distance between the Markland spectrum. So it says that you get a stability estimate. You know the isometric class of G and G0 are controlled by some power of the essentially the quotient of the Markland spectrum. And the last theorem, so we use this local rigidity to get a global sort of global rigidity, which is not, of course, does not solve the problem, but at least says something. Yes, psi is close to identity. It's actually you can express in terms of epsilon. So psi essentially epsilon close to identity. And the last theorem, before I explain a bit of the proof. Is the following. So if we fix let M a closed manifold. So we can show that if you fix an A, positive A, and if you fix a sequence where BK are positive numbers, for any sequence and any A, there exists, at most, finitely many isometric class of metric with curvature less than minus A. And so RG is not just the Riemann tensor. And the k-bound, if you differentiate the curvature tensor k time with respect to g, this is bounded by bk. So in fact, okay, so it says that if you want, if you assume that the curvature is bounded a priori by some given bound in C infinity, oh, and of course I forgot, with the same, with this, and the same Markland spectrum. So if you know, it said that if you know that the curvature is negative and bounded in C infinity by some fixed thing, you can, there is at most finitely many with the same Markland spectrum. In fact, from the proof, it's clear that we don't need bound in C infinity, we just need bound in Cn for some n depending on the dimension. But it's not so explicit, so we prefer to write it in this way. So how to obtain this? Basically, it comes from theorem 1, which is a local rigidity, plus a compactness result. So you need to show, I'll tell a word in the end, but essentially the idea is just that if you have a family of metric with bounded curvature and the radius of injectivity bounded below uniformly, there is a theorem of Hamilton which says that you can extract a subsequence which converges. So a subsequence, but the subsequence, of course, you have a sequence of diffeomorphism involved in there. And once you know you have a subsequence which converges, you reduce to the local rigidity result. So to get something better, to remove this sort of assumption, one would need some result which said that if you have a family of metric with the same Markland spectrum, can you extract a subsequence which converge up to pulling back by some diffeomorphism? And this is not so clear. Essentially, the question is how from the Markland spectrum one can get geometric information on the curvature or something like this. So one way one could think is to go to the spectrum of the Laplacian, because we know there are relations between spectrum of Laplacian and length spectrum. So if one could relate to spectrum of Laplacian, there are some result, compactness result like this by Osgood, Philippe Sarnak, or other people later in higher dimensions. So there is plenty of possible thing to do with this, but so far we just assume this condition. So let me explain the proof now. I want to do the proof of this result. It's very similar to the theorem one. I'll just explain theorem one. And essentially, the stability estimate comes from the proof, so you'll see. So the proof involves several aspects. So of course, it's a nonlinear, it's a local result. The problem is really nonlinear. This map LG is nonlinear with respect to G. Yes?
But do you have any estimate of the amount of isometric classes? That
no, not yet. But that's a good question. It would be nice to have something. So let me explain the idea of the proof. I have 25 minutes or 20 minutes?
30 minutes.
Oh, 30 minutes, okay. So plenty of time. So of course, what you have this map. You consider this map. G give map to LG, which is the Markland spectrum map. This map is not so good. It's actually better to consider this quotient, because this is going to be bounded when G is close to G0. So you fix, G0 is fixed, and you consider this map, which I will denote by L of G. And this one is going to belong to L infinity of C, because if two metric are comparable, it's not hard to see that the Markland spectrum are going to be, this is bounded by the quotient of the two metric, basically. So this is going to be an infinity of this space. So this G belongs to metric, you can say in CK, for instance, on M. And you have a gauge invariance, which is the diffeomorphism invariance. So the idea would be to mod out by the, you would like to mod out by the diffeomorphism group. And in fact, because we are working locally, we can actually take those which are isotopic to identity or homotopic to identity. So G is near G0. And you would like to, the idea for a local result would be to try to prove an implicit function theorem. You would like, one would like to prove an implicit function theorem. And that would make the deal. Of course, life is not as good as you might expect, so in fact this doesn't work. So one cannot really prove an implicit function theorem, so this fails. Well, at least we cannot prove it, but I think it's impossible to prove, actually. I believe it's wrong. So what means proving an implicit function theorem? It means you have to linearize, and you need the linearization to be an isomorphism. To be an isomorphism, here you're working in infinite dimension. So to be an isomorphism, you would need the range to be closed, and that's the difficult part. I mean, okay, so let me explain a bit what is the linearization first. So in fact, if one look carefully, it is maybe possible that Nash-Moser type theorem might work for this. But we do something a bit more by hand. So the usual implicit function theorem will fail, that's almost certain. But you might expect a Nash-Moser type, so some sort of loss of regularity. So first, what you can try to do is make a Taylor expansion of this map. So we do a Taylor expansion. This you can do by stability result. So it's a lemma, which essentially is a corollary of the stability for another flow. Which is Anosov or Moser. And in fact, the version we use is Dolayave-Markov-Morian. So the stability result tells you that, in fact, if you fix a C, for C fixed, so you fix a conjugacy class in pi 1, the map G map to LG of C, which is just the length of the geodesic in this homotopy class, this is going to be irregular. This is going to be C2 at least. So here you need G in the space of C3 metric. So it's a C2 map on this Banach space. So it says that you can actually expand LG L of G is going to be L of G0, which is just 1, because you remember it was LG or LG0, plus the linearization times the difference, plus a term of order 2, so something which is controlled by the square in C3 norm. Okay, so this is fine. So now if you assume that LG is equal to LG0, you get 0 if LG equal LG0 equal 1, which is your assumption. What you get is that the linearization applied to this tensor, this is a tensor here, in C3 of M, a tensor of order 2, symmetric tensor of order 2, T star M. You know that this is going to be a big O of G minus G0 to the square. So now one has to compute what is this linearization. So actually, sorry, this is the linearization at G0, not at G. I'm doing a Taylor expansion at G0. So we get this. That's the first thing which is important to notice. Now, what is the linearization? So the linearization, it has been studied a lot, actually, since the work of Gilmin and Kasdan from the 80s. It's called the X-ray transform. It appears in tensor tomography. And it's something which is very natural. It's just integrating functions or tensors on closed geodesic. So let me explain what is DLG. DLG0 is called the geodesic X-ray transform. And in fact, will be denoted. We will denote it by I2 of G0. So why two is for, because I'll explain a bit, but the two correspond to two tensors because we're working with metric, so there are symmetric two tensors. So what is this I2 of G0? So it's an operator which say maps C0 or C3 if you want, but let's define it for C0 of M symmetric tensor of order 2 to L infinity of C, and it's just you take a symmetric tensor H and to a conjugacy class C you map to 1 over the length. Gamma C integral over gamma C of the tensor. So how to integrate a tensor along a closed geodesic? What you do is you contract it with the derivative of the geodesic. So this is an element in unit tangent bundle. Bt. So that's the natural, so gamma dot means just the tangent vector to the geodesic. So this is the called the X-ray transform for two tensors. So in fact, it's quite instructive to view, you see, integrating a function along closed geodesic, this makes more sense when you view the function on the unit tangent bundle, not on the manifold. So two tensors on M, they are actually quadratic function in the unit tangent bundle. So you can view a symmetric tensor as a special type of function on the unit tangent bundle. So there is a natural map, which I'll denote by P star 2, which to a function, a symmetric two tensor, associate a function on SM. So SM is just the unit tangent bundle. And it's just you take H and you map to the function which to. So X is a point on the base on M and V is the tangent vector in the fiber. So V here is in TXM with norm 1. And it's just the function H, X, and you contract with V. So it's just a natural way to view a tensor on M as a function on SM. So I define this, and then I can also define the X-ray transform as an operator on SM, which is just integration on function on closed geodesic viewed as closed orbit of the geodesic flow on SM. So I'll denote by I. So here there is no 2 anymore. It's just the map which to C0 of SM map to L infinity of C. And which to a function f associate the L infinity function, which to C give the integral of f along so from 0 energy 0 of gamma C f gamma C of t gamma dot C of t dt. 1 over the length. So here, this is really the closed orbit of the geodesic flow. Geodesic flow on SM. Okay. And what is I2? I2 is just I of G0 composed with this pullback from tensors to function on SM. Okay? It's just follow from the definition, essentially. So now, this two operator will be of major importance in what we do. So this is the linearization. So if you want a local result, you need to show that this I2 is injective. That's the first thing. So this is actually well known. So the study of this type of operator goes back to at least in this setting some old work of Gilmin and Kasdan. In dimension 2, and then they worked, I think in the 80s, they worked in higher dimension. The study of I2. So let me state a theorem about this I2. So I2 is known to be injective as long as I assume that G0 satisfies the assumption of my theorem, which means either the G0 has another flow and M is a surface, or it is a higher dimensional ANOSOV flow, but with non-positive curvature. So that's a theorem. So if MG0 is, let's see how to state it. Okay, sorry. First, I want to mention that the kernel of I2 contain all the Lie derivative of G0, where V is a infinity vector field on M. Okay, because these are variations of diffeomorphism, and it's an easy thing to check that. If you integrate over a closed orbit something which is a Lie derivative of the metric, you get zero. So this is just the gauge invariance. So I2 will not be, when you look at the action on tensors, it will not be injective because of this gauge due to diffeomorphism. But once you mod out by this, you may ask if it's injective. So, and this is what the theorem say. So we will say that I2 is injective, say, if the kernel is really equal. So it's not really injective, but people call it solenoidal injective. But I'll just say injective. So for me, injectivity of I2 means that the kernel are equal. So if equality, we say that I2 is injective. The kernel is really just the Lie derivative, or just the Lie derivative. So is injective in the following case. So either dimension of M is 2 and G0 ANOSOV flow has ANOSOV geodesic flow, or dimension M is bigger than 2, G0 has ANOSOV geodesic flow, and the curvature is non-positive. So this case was actually proved by Paternine, Salo-Ullmann, 2014, and I gave kind of a related. I also have a proof in some paper in 17, which is a bit related to this idea. And for this case, this was proved by Kroc and Sharafudinov. '98. And there is also proof by Paternine, Solow, and Ullmann. 2014. This. So it said that the linearized operator is actually as good as we want. It's really injective, or at least the kernel is just the tangent space to the diffeomorphism. So now to apply to say something about the nonlinear problem, as I said, one would like to get a stability estimate to prove that this has closed range. So this is a tricky question. So here is what we do. 15 minutes. So first remark it's a classical result in differential geometry. First, any metric, any actually, well, let's say infinity, but it works with CK or CK. Any metric close to G0, we can decompose it. It is of the form G. G equal G0, sorry, psi star G0, so G is of the form psi star G0 plus H, where H is divergence free with respect to G0. So this is a divergence operator. So the divergence operator is the adjoint of the map V give the Lie derivative. So this is what I call DG0 is this map. V so it goes from vector field to two tensors, and if you take the adjoint. This is a divergence, essentially. And it's a sort of slice theorem. It says that you can always pull back the given metric by default so such that the rest is divergence free. And in fact, when you look at this, what I call injective, it's really saying that it's injective actually on divergence free tensor. So this thing is really, in fact, injective on the kernel of DG0 star, if you model by this gauge. So you have to think, just if you're not familiar with this, think about this as a quotienting by the gauge. So the gauge is not really a serious problem, this diffeomorphism invariance locally. So it says that, in fact, we can always assume, we can always reduce to the case where G minus G0 is divergence free with respect to G0. It sort of said that it's orthogonal to the slice, the orbit of the diffeomorphism action. Okay? So now, the whole difficulty in this problem is that this I2 operator, it map to L infinity function on the discrete set. So it's not very convenient to work with. Get estimate, stability estimate on this operator is a really tricky thing. So what the new, I think the really new trick in what we do is by bringing a new operator which kind of replaces this and has much better properties. And I'll explain quickly how is defined this operator. So this operator, it comes from dynamics, actually, from long-time dynamics. So you see, difficulties that closed orbit are kind of discrete set, so it's not so nice. So you would like to replace the integral over closed orbit in terms of integral over all the orbits. So what we can, what we do is that we define an operator as follow. I'll denote it pi. So a priori, pi goes from C infinity function on SM to the dual, which are just distribution. And it's defined by this condition. So the pairing is just the limit when lambda goes to 0 plus. So what you do, you integrate over R. You put a damping. And you apply to the correlation. So this is just the L2 pairing here. So this is called a correlation function in dynamic. And you integrate. So of course, for this, I have to assume that F is orthogonal to constant. So you know that the correlation for geodesic flow in negative curvature, they're going to converge to equilibrium very fast, actually exponentially fast by some result of Liverani, for instance. So this thing, if the average of F is 1, it's actually going to be a big O of t to minus infinity, in fact, exponentially decaying. So it means that when you let lambda go to 0, this actually makes sense. But for this decay to hold, you need F to have regularity. And in fact, this is true also. This actually holds if F is holder, for instance, and F prime holder for some alpha positive. So if you look at correlation with a little bit of regularity, you get strong decay, and you can define this operator. So let me say, so roughly speaking, what is this pi operator? It maps function to distribution, so not to function, but you have to think of it as pi f at a point x. Of course, it's not it's real distribution, so you cannot really make sense of it. It's really like the integration of f along the geodesic. Of course, you cannot make sense of this because it's just plus infinity. But this operator sort of replaces this by. But you have to view it as a map to distribution. That's it. And this operator is the key to solving the problem. So this operator has very nice properties. This we proved. I proved in some previous work. It has the following property. So pi, it's a bounded operator for any s positive, it maps to h minus s, sm. So it almost maps L2 to L2, but not quite. You need to apply to a little bit of Sobolev regularity, and it maps to a little bit of negative Sobolev regularity. It's killed, so if x is the vector field of the flow, of G0. If you compose pi with x, it's 0 on HS. And also, pi x is 0 on u in HS, such that x u is in HS. So that's. So this operator maps to invariant distribution, actually. And in fact, its range, its range essentially. If you take the closure, you get all the invariant distribution. So that's the first thing. And now the second thing. So for this result, it's based on some work of Faure and Jostrand and Liverani, Butterley. Butterley, Liverani. I really use more for Jostrand, but the first work in this setting was by Butterley-Liverani. And this is based on the theory of anisotropic Sobolev space adapted to the dynamic. And the second property, which is the key one, I mean, this is one key one, but the one which is really important, is that we get stability for this operator. We get nice estimates. So, if you apply this operator to function which are symmetric tensors, so you take symmetric tensor, you view it as a function on SM, and you look at the H minus S norm, this control. So as long as F is divergence free, this control the norm in H minus S minus 1 on M. So this was also proved, this follows also from my paper in 17. So we get really a stability estimate for this guy in some certain norm. While for I2, it was not possible to get. You see? So now the question to go to the nonlinear problem and use the linear problem is how to relate this linearized operator to this pi operator, because you see this pi is defined by a correlation thing, and this is done by some sort of Lifshitz theorem, and in fact this is related to the talk of Jairo. This is for this we use some work of Lopez and Thielen on a positive Lifshitz theorem, which is related to this subordination Manier lemma, Manier result. So there is a positive Lifshitz theorem. I don't have the time to finish, but so there is some in the work of Lopez and Thielen. 03. It says that if f is a Hölder function on SM and the integral of f along all closed orbits is positive, non-negative, then there exists U Hölder and f prime Hölder, such that f is a co-boundary plus f prime, and f prime is positive. And also you have bound on f prime. So f prime, the norm of f prime in C beta is controlled by the norm of f in C alpha, with some C depending just on the flow. So now just maybe 1 minute to conclude. How to use these things? So you, what you can show is that if LG is bigger than LG zero, then the integral over gamma C closed geodesic of G0 of the difference, that's an easy thing to do, is actually positive. So this is this difference of metric, I'll call it H, and I can always assume it's divergence free by what I said before. So H is actually divergence free with respect to G0. So I have this positivity here. So I can apply this Lopez-Thielen result. So it says that H is actually X of U plus H prime. And this guy is positive and controlled in some Hölder norm by the norm of H. So now, to conclude the result, we can do as follow. So we know, so if you know that the integral over all closed orbit is positive, you can always approximate the, if you integrate H along the Liouville measure, this is going, or pi to H, sorry. So, okay, here I identify function and tensors, function on SM and tensor downstairs. Having positive integral over closed orbit say that imply also that the average for the Liouville measure is positive, because we can approximate the Liouville measure by a very long integral over a closed orbit. So one has this. So we get some estimate like this. This is bounded by actually I2 G0 of H. Maybe twice or something. Again, because the average over the Liouville measure, you can approximate, you can bound above by some integral along very long orbit. And this, because we assume they have the same length spectrum, when you do the Taylor expansion, what you get is that this is bounded by a constant depending on G0 times the square here for some CK norm, C3 maybe. And now, from this, I'll just finish right now. What you get is the following. So you take the H minus S minus 1 norm. It's bounded by my estimate on the pi operator here. I apply this with this H. It's bounded by a constant time pi 2 star H minus S. H minus S, bounded by C prime, another constant time. Then I use that this operator is bounded. So it's pi 2 star of H. Now this guy I write as XU plus H prime. So because pi x is 0, I can actually remove this guy. So I replace now h by h prime. And this guy is positive. That's the key now. And because this guy is positive here, I have this in hs norm now, because pi was bounded from hs to h minus s. Now I interpolate. This hs norm, I can interpolate between L2 and some h big. So I get h prime L2 time almost 1, so 1 minus some epsilon, and h prime hn, some very big norm n here with some norm epsilon of n, so something very close to 1, just interpolation. And now this is bounded here a priori, so this is small, bounded by delta, and here I just use Taylor, Jensen, sorry. So it's just the L1 norm to 1/2 times the H prime times the L infinity norm times some delta here, which is just the difference between the two metric. And here, because I have L1 norm of H prime and H prime is positive, this is just the integral of H prime over the Liouville measure to the 1/2. And this H prime, I can write it again as XU plus H or minus H. But XU is, it's a coboundary, so again, the Liouville measure is 0. So I get back H here. So I bound above by H L1 1/2 times this. And now, I can use the bound with the I2 here. I get an h square here. So you know I have a 1/2 and a square. So I come back with h to the power 1, essentially, here, with some CK norm. And essentially, you get, in the end, you play a bit with this. You do some interpolation. And what you get is that h minus 1 minus s is bounded by h minus 1 minus s, maybe to some power 1 plus alpha, which is positive, times delta. So power bigger than 1. So it said that if h is small enough, it's 0. So that's the idea. So sorry, it's a bit technical at the end, but the paper is online. So if you want to really see the detail. Just the idea to have is based on this Lopez-Thuelin positive Lipschitz theorem and this new operator where we have a good estimate. Sorry for that.
Question?
Yes.
I was just the moment to define the operator pi to star of index.
No, pi to star is just the operator which to a tensor on M, a symmetric tensor on M, associate a function on SM. It was just this.
Okay, okay.
Just by contracting with V. So you have a tensor.
Okay, yes. Thank you.
I heard about this problem, but
somehow it's almost the same problem for symmetric spaces. It is called in the same way because it implies.
So it's known generically, no, that is true.
Sorry.
It's not known that generically this is the case.
Maybe. So for surfaces it is true. Dimension 3 is not true.
I don't know. Maybe.
Maybe you have a local theorem, you have a local version that is symmetric.
Yeah, could be actually. I haven't thought about it, but it's maybe something to look at. The Lyapunov spectrum, I think maybe.
Because there are connections with symmetric spaces, if you know the Lyapunov spectrum.
Is the Lyapunov spectrum determining the Lyapunov spectrum? I'm not. I don't know if it's known. I'm not sure. I mean, I don't quite see how from length of geodesic. I'm not sure. Yeah, maybe, but I don't know.
Okay, any other questions?